Namaskar, good evening. You are watching News Tonight. I'm Smriti Rastogi. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. Monsoon session of Parliament to begin on 18th July and end on 10th of August. Anti-triple talaq bill among the key legislations topping government's agenda. Rajya Sabha to also elect its deputy chairman. Intolerant citizens violating freedom of others are no Indians, asserts Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu, releases Prasar Bharati Chairman A. Surya Prakash's book titled Emergency, Indian Democracy's Darkest Hour. BJP observes Black Day on 43rd anniversary of Emergency. India Seychelles to jointly develop naval base on Assumption Island. Six MOUs inked after summit-level talks between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Seychelles President Danny Faure. Prime Minister Modi announces $100 million line of credit to boost Seychelles' military infrastructure. Take care, tells Prime Minister Narendra Modi to the Indian Air Force Guard who collapsed during the Guard of Honour for Seychelles' president. After the ceremony, the Prime Minister walks up to the airman and asks him to be careful about his health. Three killed as heavy rain slashed Mumbai for the second consecutive day. Waterlogging reported from several areas. Six people also killed in West Bengal in heavy monsoon rains and thunderstorms. The monsoon session of the Parliament will commence from 18th of July and end on August 10th, the Cabinet Committee of Parliamentary Affairs recommended on Monday. The CCPA, chaired by Home Minister Rajnath Singh, met on Monday. The President will now formally convene the session. The session will have nearly 18 sittings. Parliamentary Affairs Minister Anant Kumar said more than six ordinances will be taken up during the session. The anti-triple talaq bill, which has been passed by the Lok Sabha and is pending in the Rajya Sabha, will be among the top priorities of the government. The government will also push for constitutional status for the National Commission for OBCs. Besides this, National Medical Commission Bill 2017, Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill 2016 and Rights of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Second Amendment Bill 2017 will also be taken up. The minister also appealed to the opposition leaders to ensure a smooth conduct of the session. The election to choose the deputy chairman for the Rajya Sabha will also be taken up in this session.
OBC कमीशन को संवैधानिक दर्जा देने का जो विधेयक है वो हम पारित करवाएंगे ट्रिपल तलाक जैसी मुस्लिम महिलाओं को उनके विवाह के संबंध में जो सुरक्षा देना ऐसे एक बिल जो लोकसभा ने पारित किया है वो राज्यसभा के समक्ष होगा तो उसको भी पारित करने का हमारा इरादा है
एंड इंडिया एंड सेशल्स हैव डिसाइडेड टू जॉइंटली वर्क ऑन क्रिएटिंग अ नेवल बेस इन स्ट्रेटेजिकली इंपॉर्टेंट अजम्पशन आइलैंड इन इंडियन ओशन इंडिया एंड सेशल्स इंक्ड सिक्स एमओयूज आफ्टर समिट लेवल टॉक्स बिटवीन प्राइम मिनिस्टर नरेंद्र मोदी एंड सेशल्स प्रेसिडेंट हियर आर द डिटेल्स
अनसर्टेनिटी ओवर द फ्यूचर ऑफ इंडियाज प्रेजेंस ऑन स्ट्रेटेजिकली इंपॉर्टेंट अजम्पशन आइलैंड इज ओवर Seychelles President Danny Faure has announced that both countries will develop the island together. India had long proposed creating a naval base on the island but faced resistance from the opposition of the country. India has its strategic interests on the island. It can keep a watch on the movement of ships in the Indian Ocean, including near Pakistan and Iran, from there.
Assumption Dweep project ke sambandh mein ek dusre ke hiton ke aadhar par milkar kaam karne par हम सहमत हैं नेविगेशन चार्ट्स की उपलब्धता को सुधारने के लिए हाइड्रोग्राफी सर्वेस करने के लिए हम व्यापक रूप से सहयोग कर रहे हैं
इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ मैरीटाइम सिक्योरिटी Assumption Island was discussed. We are equally engaged and will continue to work together, bearing each other's interest in mind. We have underscored our commitment to remain at the heart of joint initiatives and collective efforts to stimulate and facilitate cooperation in fields representing priorities on the sub-regional, regional, and continental agendas.
Foray, who's on a six-day visit to India, had announced earlier that there would be no talks on Assumption Island. On the contrary, the issue was discussed in detail. During the summit-level meeting, India also announced an easy loan of $100 million for buying defense equipment. Both sides also signed six agreements on comprehensive development partnership in infrastructure development, education, cybersecurity, data sharing on ships, municipal cooperation between Panaji and Victoria, and training of Seychelles Foreign Service officials. India will also build the Seychelles Governor House, Police Headquarters and Attorney General Office Building.
मैंने सेशेल्स की राष्ट्रीय प्राथमिकता की परियोजनाओं के लिए प्रभावी योगदान को जारी रखने की भारत की प्रतिबद्धता दोहराई है। इन परियोजनाओं से न केवल सेशेल्स की अर्थव्यवस्था बेहतर होगी, बल्कि इससे हमारे आपसी संबंध कई गुना प्रगाढ़ होंगे। स्पेशल ग्रांट के अंतर्गत सेशेल्स में तीन सिविलियन इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर प्रोजेक्ट्स को फाइनेंस करने के लिए भारत तैयार है।
On behalf of the people and government of Seychelles, I would like to say thank you for the announcement that you have just made. We will benefit from a second line of credit that will help with the infrastructure of our military defense forces in Seychelles.
India has also provided a Dornier aircraft to Seychelles that will be dedicated to the country on its National Day on the 29th of June. Earlier, the Seychelles president received a guard of honor and ceremonial welcome in the forecourt of Rashtrapati Bhavan. He also met President Ramnath Kovind and Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu. Akhilesh Suman's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Meanwhile, during the guard of honor for Seychelles President Annie Faure, an IAF Jawan collapsed due to extreme heat. In a kind gesture, Prime Minister Narendra Modi walked up to the Jawan and inquired about his health after the ceremony was over and the dignitary had left. The Prime Minister spent a few minutes with the Jawan and advised him to take care of his health. On to some more news, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu on Monday asserted that a crucial lesson of emergency was that it was the responsibility of each citizen to uphold liberties and freedom of fellow citizens and that intolerance should not be accepted. He said this at a release of the Hindi, Kannada, Telugu and Gujarati versions of the book titled Emergency, India Democracy's Darkest Hour, authored by the chairman of Prasar Bharati, A. Surya Prakash, stating that no sensible government would dare to resort to emergency after the resounding pro-democracy verdict of the people in 1977. Naidu said that now the threat to individual freedom is from some misguided citizens. The vice president also calls for inclusion of emergency in the curriculum to remind the young of the darkest hour of democracy and the value of liberty and freedom.
This emergency, which is the darkest period of Indian democracy, this should also form part of our curriculum for all the youngsters to know what was emergency, how it was imposed, why it was imposed, when it was imposed, then how it got lifted.
Every generation must know about the heroes and villains of the emergency. They must read about the heroic efforts of Jai Prakash Narayan. They must also know about the true grit of Ramnath Goenka and the courage of Justice H.R. Khanna. This will encourage them to stand up to defend democratic values and our constitution.
And the Bharatiya Janata Party is observing Black Day today to mark the 43rd anniversary of emergency proclaimed in 1975. June 25th marks the day when former Prime Minister Indira Gandhi declared a state of emergency in the country. The BJP held events across the country to highlight what it calls the darkest period of Indian democracy.
देश के लोकतंत्र के इतिहास का काला समय है और आज जो है वो हमें तो आज भी लगता है कि उसी जो जिस सामंती सोच और जिस तानाशाही विचारों से कांग्रेस पार्टी उस समय भरी हुई थी आज भी उसने न सबक लिया है न सीखा है। आज भी कांग्रेस की वही सामंती सोच और वही तानाशाही सियासत चौतरफा दिखाई पड़ती है।
इमरजेंसी के बारे में हमारे यहाँ कुछ पाठ है, कुछ सामग्री है, लेकिन इसका भी रिव्यू करके एक इमरजेंसी का ये काला खंड जो है देश के लोकतंत्र पर आए हुआ आक्रमण जो है इसके बारे में भी कुछ न कुछ और किताबों में आकर नई पीढ़ी को भी ये जानकारी मिलती रहे इसके लिए हम निश्चित काम करेंगे।
And on the 43rd anniversary of emergency, the BJP organized an exhibition in the national capital organized by BJP's Rajya Sabha MP Vijay Goyal. The exhibition is displaying news clippings and letters exchanged between arrested political leaders during the period. The exhibition was inaugurated by Union Ministers Ram Vilas Paswan and Thawar Chand Gehlot and Senior BJP leader Kalraj Mishra. The exhibition also showcases photographs of leaders who were jailed during the emergency and also the letters and pamphlets distributed by the leaders protesting emergency. The two-day exhibition aims to create awareness among the people about the emergency. And in a Facebook post titled The Emergency Revisited, Union Minister Arun Jaitley wrote that more than four decades ago, the government led by the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi had imposed a phony emergency, turning democracy into a constitutional dictatorship. Indira Gandhi imposed emergency on June 25, 1975 on account of internal disturbances, suspending key fundamental rights guaranteed under the constitution to every citizen. Jaitley said that he became the first satyagrahi against Indira Gandhi's government's draconian move and was lodged in Tihar jail for organizing a protest meeting on 26 June 1975. He said that the right to free speech and personal liberty was clamped and only censored news was available. Some more news. The Gujarat High Court awarded 10 years rigorous imprisonment to three convicts in 2002 Naruda Patia massacre case. The three were acquitted by a trial court in 2012, but the High Court reversed the judgment and convicted them of arson and being part of a violent mob that killed 97 people from the minority community in the aftermath of the Sabarmati Express train burning. In its order on the quantum of sentence, the court observed that the crimes committed by them were against society and their punishment must be consistent with the brutality with which the crime was committed. And the CBI has moved the Supreme Court challenging a Delhi High Court order granting bail to Karthi Chidambaram in INX media case. In its appeal, the CBI has said that it was impermissible in law for the High Court to entertain Karthi's bail plea when an application seeking a similar relief was pending before the trial court. Karthi was arrested in February this year over alleged irregularities in FIPB clearance given to INX Media and was granted bail by the Delhi High Court in March after being questioned in CBI custody for 23 days. And now the news from the national capital. The Delhi High Court has asked the National Buildings Construction Corporation to not cut any more trees in the national capital till July 4th. The High Court was hearing a plea seeking a stay on felling of more trees for redevelopment of seven South Delhi colonies. The NBCC has assured the court that it will not fell any more trees till the next hearing. Reports said that more than 16,000 trees were to be felled for redevelopment work in the national capital. And with that, time for a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us. Welcome back. You are watching News Tonight. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu delivered the 19th Vaikunth Bhai Mehta Memorial Lecture in the National Capital on Monday. He lauded Vaikunth Bhai Mehta's pioneering contribution to the growth of cooperative movement in the country. The Vice President underlined the role of agricultural cooperatives in achieving the government's target of doubling farmers' income by 2022. The Vice President said that India has more than 8 lakh cooperatives that can bridge the urban-rural divide and can create opportunities for income generation. He called on cooperatives to find mutual synergies with the public and private sector so as to explore new avenues of resource generation. He added, there are tremendous opportunities for cooperatives in solving the problem of unemployment, particularly in the rural areas where the poor lack skills. He also called for them to fully utilize the power of technology in their functioning.
We need to strengthen cooperatives so that they can work for the welfare of the farmers and give them credit at the time they need a reasonable rate of interest. I am pleased that the present government is committed to encourage the cooperative movement. We have an example in case of NAFED where the government have given a guarantee to a tune of 40,000 crores. Cooperatives for their sustainable existence and to serve the members better have to diversify their operations in new areas like honeybee production, seaweed farming, etc. The cooperatives should also train the farmers in the right of use of fertilizers and also train them in new technologies related to agriculture farming. The cooperatives through their wide network in the rural areas have won the trust of the farmers more than any other institution. Various schemes of the government like Jana Dhana Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bhima Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana, Mudra Scheme provide a good opportunity for the cooperatives to collaborate with the government and reap multiple benefits. Because there is every need to strengthen the cooperative movement among the women. Women know the value of money. They won't waste money. That's why the government is putting money in their account. And then if the self-help groups become sustainable.
And getting you all the weather news now, the southwest monsoon has picked up momentum in Mumbai. Heavy showers have claimed at least 3 lives in the city and adjoining Thane. The heavy downpour through the whole of the Sunday night as well as Monday morning caused massive water logging at several places. The movement of suburban trains was also affected, causing inconvenience to office goers. Meanwhile, heavy rains and thunderstorms also claimed 5 lives in West Bengal. In western India, heavy rains lashed several parts of South Gujarat, particularly Valsad, Surat and Navsari districts, causing waterlogging and throwing normal life out of gear in the region. In Odisha, the southwest monsoon regained steam after a brief hiatus, triggering heavy showers accompanied by thunderstorms in several parts of the state. The Met Department says the rain-bearing winds are likely to cover the entire state over the next 2 days. And in Assam, the flood situation saw slight improvement with waters in major rivers receding below the danger level. At least 2 people reportedly drowned in Kachar district, taking the death toll to 26. According to the Assam State Disaster Management Authority, more than 96,000 people in 5 districts were reeling under the impact of the flood. Getting the international news, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan is taking on extensive new executive powers following his outright election victory in Sunday's poll. Erdogan polled nearly 53% of the votes in the most fiercely fought election in recent years, while the opposition candidate, Ince, received just 31%. In his victory speech to the supporters, Erdogan vowed to rapidly implement the new presidential system agreed in April 2017 referendum that opponents fear will give him autocratic powers. Erdogan was prime minister for 11 years before becoming president in 2014. And now all the FIFA news. Portugal will take on Iran in a must-win game of their league stage luster tonight. At the same time, the Spain takes on Morocco. They are currently tied with Spain at the top of the Group B with 4 points each. A win against Iran will get them through to the round 16. Iran, on the other hand, looked solid when they beat Morocco before going down fighting 1-0 against Spain.
Cristiano Ronaldo and the rest of Portugal World Cup squad trained on Sunday ahead of the last Group B clash with Iran, the match that will decide who advances through to the next round. Portugal sits tied with Spain on 4 points, while Iran is right behind on 3 points. Portugal has looked good but have been tested at the back line, especially in the game against Morocco, who opened up its defence on few occasions and looked like scoring an equaliser. Thanks largely to the brilliance of Ronaldo, who has scored 4 goals in the tournament so far, of which 3 has come against Spain in a stunning 3-3 draw. This will be second World Cup clash between the two sides after 2006 World Cup, where the Europeans had come out victorious by 2-0. Even there, Ronaldo had scored along with Deco. Meanwhile, Portuguese won 3 of the 4 matches against any Asian side. The last loss against them came in 2002 World Cup group game against a co-host South Korea. On the other hand, Iran has remained winless in the 7 matches against any European side in the World Cup. The Iranian team is currently led by former Portugal coach Carlos Queiroz, who will be looking to secure the spot in the last 16. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Meanwhile, Spain will face Morocco in their last group game tonight. The game will decide Spain's march ahead into the round of 16. A loss in this match will leave them at the mercy of goal differences and result of the other match being played simultaneously.
Even though it is a dead rubber for Morocco, who's already been eliminated from the World Cup, Spain would be eyeing a big victory to float through to the second round. With 4 points, they are tied with Portugal in Group B, but just ahead of Iran, who is on 3 points. A draw may sail Spain through, given Portugal does not lose to Iran, but any other combination of results may just complicate the permutations in Group B.
Muchas veces se tiende a relajarse por un tercer partido y nosotros no podemos. Nosotros tenemos que estar con las luces muy abiertas, los ojos muy abiertos, saber que nadie nos va a regalar nada y lo que tengamos que conseguir lo haremos a través de nuestro trabajo y de nuestro esfuerzo y hacer las cosas bien, ¿no?
The Moroccans will be playing for pride and will try to make it hard for Spain to come out on the top.
En ce troisième match, mais il faut accepter la réalité, il faut se concentrer sur ce troisième match et sauver notre honneur, puisqu'aujourd'hui il n'y a plus que ça à sauver.
Morocco was ousted after 2 straight losses they suffered against Iran and Portugal. On the other hand, the 2010 world champions haven't looked in the top form, but have played with composure and grit, overcoming the out-of-field events right at the start of their World Cup campaign. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And for in-depth analysis of all the day's matches with our experts in the studio, watch our special daily show on the FIFA World Cup at 7 p.m. It is a new show timing for our football World Cup coverage, as the match timings too have changed. The first one at 7:30 p.m. So don't forget to tune in. And that's all we have for you in this edition of News Tonight. For more news and updates, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.